having just celebrated her 50th anniversary, and so this is something that no one else in the family has done before. So Irene, we just want to get your viewpoint of our masked family history, and tell me a little bit, what are the earliest things you remember?
The earliest memories that I have, well, let me see. It was before I went to school, for sure.
Yeah.
And I remember living at the place that we recognized as the place where the barn burned down. I do not remember living at the Little Red House.
You don't remember living there, huh?
No. My first memory is of the place where the barn burnt down, and I remember wooden floors. For some reason, to me, the floors didn't have linoleum on them. They were wooden, and the nice stairway that it had a very nice banister on it, one that you could slide down.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember doing that. We slid down the banisters. And I also remember an accident that happened on the stairway when Lily and I shared a room, and we had a little nighttime chamber in the room.
Mm-hmm.
And we used that at night. And then she's older than I am, so she had to carry the chamber down the steps the next morning, and she fell going down the steps. And Everything fell, yeah. That made an impression on me because I was coming along behind.
There you go.
I should have been ahead, I guess.
Yeah.
But I remember the stairway because it was so nice. And I also remember writing on the wall upstairs.
Mm-hmm.
And Mom said that wasn't good. We had wallpaper on the wall and the coloring didn't come off.
So you scribbled on it.
I scribbled something on there. I don't know what it was, but I think I was practicing ABC.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and I just noticed that big empty space, so I put a few letters, and they were big. I remember writing big, just made big ones.
Now, do you remember being Amish?
I remember wearing Amish dress, and I think Mommy Byler made them for us out of feed bags. They were, first she took the feed bags and bleached them, I believe, to get the markings out. And then she made the dresses and then dyed them brown. And I just thought they were just plain ugly colored. And Lily had them too.
Mm-hmm.
We both had these dresses. We had to wear them to school. And they were tan, kind of tan colored.
Mm-hmm.
And probably it covered up the writing, what the bleach didn't take out.
Mm-hmm.
And we didn't have a lot of money and not a lot of clothes, and Mom was very busy with her family, and this helped Mom out a great deal because Grandma made the dresses for us, so we certainly had to wear them. We wore them. But I don't remember about going to the Amish church too much, but I do remember one time falling asleep while we were praying. I woke up, everybody was up but me, and I was on my knees. So I know that was in the Amish church. That's about all I can remember. But I always remember Dad having some kind of a vehicle.
Some kind of a motorized vehicle?
Like a dune buggy type of a truck. I don't know what it was called, but I know that it was sort of to be a secret type of a
truck. Okay, you knew other people weren't to know about.
Yeah, we weren't.
Tell other people.
That's right. And so, and Mom didn't really approve of it.
Okay.
And so when we went to see Grandma during the day, Mom always took the horse and the Durbin.
Oh, okay.
I remember that.
You remember riding the horse and Durbin?
Yeah, I can just see us going down that road. We went the long way around. I don't think we went past Henry Schrock's, and we'd go to Grandma's.
Now, what do you remember about Grandma and Dottie during your young days?
They had a very neat house. I liked that. I liked the porch that goes up to the kitchen. It was maybe four steps or so, and the shade tree always was nice. And then Grandpa had made a cement walk out to the little outhouse.
Mm-hmm.
And that was something we didn't have cement, anything cement
had
around.
Cement.
And I remember the walk. And just a nice, neat house. And Mommy always had a big smile on her face, and she made you feel real important.
Mm-hmm.
And then Uncle Adams lived next door, and we liked to go over and visit Ada.
And
she was a favorite cousin for a long time. And I also remember Luther Lyons. mm-hmm. the neighbor.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't care for them much because the daughter, Dolores, who eventually ended up living in close to Greenwood.
Wow.
And we lived next door to Luther's. And they were fine people, but I was a little jealous of them because Dolores loved horses. And she, Grandpa let her pay attention to Rex, the horse.
Mm-hmm.
And we weren't allowed with the horses.
But
Dolores could. Mm-hmm. Dolores Lyons, and I felt that we had more rights to that horse than what she did. He was our grandpa, not hers. But I never said it. I just mm-hmm. kept that to myself. Mm-hmm. But I think we were taught not to talk about or say things about other people,
mm-hmm.
and so you didn't. We didn't do that.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it was Grandma and Grandpa Byler were important people. To me,
mm-hmm.
and I'm sure they were to the rest, but we always felt glad when we went over there.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember the time you went over there and got in the bees.
You remember that? You were long?
Mm-hmm. Yes, I remember Mom combing your hair, and mm-hmm. we thought we had everything out, and you said, no, there's one more, I can hear it. And you had curls.
Mm, yeah, that's
thick
right.
Thick curls.
Yeah.
And then finally Mom would find it. And sure enough, there was another bee.
Did I vomit on the way home?
I don't remember.
Mom
that.
Said I did.
Oh, you yeah. probably did, because you were stung quite a few times up around
yeah.
your head. So
yeah.
you probably
yeah.
did.
Yeah.
Anyway, it was, and Grandma and Grandpa Mass, we didn't go there as much.
Mm-hmm.
Because Mommy Mass was sick. And we were cautioned every time we go in their house, don't get against the bed, don't bump the bed, don't jump, don't talk loud. You know, it was
uh-huh.
We were made to understand we have to take care of.
So you had more restrictions visiting Grandpa Mass and Grandpa Byler. We were more at home, Grandpa.
Yeah,
Byler.
We were more at home. Grandpa Byler was always teaching us stuff or telling us jokes, although he did have arthritis.
Mm-hmm.
And he felt very laid up, and he said that he couldn't do a lot of things because his hands were crippled.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And
but he was still walking around.
He still walked around. His hands were worse than his feet
mm-hmm.
first. And I have some arthritis in my hands, but certainly not like he has. He was very much crippled with his hands.
Mm-hmm. Now tell me a little bit about your schooling. Do you remember Pratt School? Is that the first school you went to?
That was the first school I went to. I actually made up some kindergarten years or time there.
Okay.
We didn't have kindergarten. I just went.
Oh, you went?
Yeah.
With Lily? Before your time?
Well, what happened, I wanted to go to school. I
uh-huh.
just couldn't wait. And after the children all went to school that were old enough, I'd wait around, watch my chance, and go change my dress and run over to the school.
Oh, I see. You could get, it was within walking distance.
Oh, yes. Uh-huh. It was at the same place where the barn burned down.
Oh.
But it was not very far away.
Okay.
And Mom said she would notice I wasn't around, so she'd start looking. And but she thought about what maybe that I would change my dress, so she went and looked for my Sunday dress, and it was gone.
Oh, okay.
So she knew I went to school. And she couldn't, with little ones, she had, I guess, one or two little ones, and she couldn't leave them and mm-hmm. go look for me, so she just let me stay there.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know what time of the day I went, but I spent the day in school, and the children had fun with me, because I couldn't speak much English.
Mm-hmm.
And they'd say, how do you say this in Dutch, and how do you say that in Dutch? And I was saying the words.
Yeah, yeah.
And
yeah.
then they came to colors. We didn't say crayons. We'd say it's a coloring book. And they'd say, how do you say color in Dutch? And I'd say color. And they'd say, no, say it in Dutch. And I would just say color. And they thought I wasn't saying the word.
Right,
right.
right
but
right.
there was no word that
there
I
There was
knew.
A word. You just used the English word.
But that's when I was probably five.
When you were five, uh-huh. Now, when you actually went to school, who was your teacher?
Agnes Webb.
Agnes Webb. Was she strict?
Oh, yeah. She had red hair, and we were warned that she was going to be hard to deal
oh,
with
okay.
because she had red hair and a temper. I don't remember the temper part. Mostly about school, I remember the boys were rowdy and sat in the back of the room.
Mm.
And they kind of carried on back there, and she didn't have very good control of that.
Mm-hmm.
And then I remember the war drills.
Mm-hmm. Oh, war drills, okay.
And we had to, she gave the signal. I don't think it was a signal from the government. She gave a signal and something, and we all had to run out and lay in the cornfield, flat down.
Flat down, is that right?
Flat down in the cornfield. And we were told there could be bombs, so that's why you laid down. And forever after that, when airplanes came, I still have that urge if I have to go lay down.
Lay down.
If wherever you are, just lay flat.
Is that right? Yeah. My early experience there.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And I was terrified that there could be a bomb.
So how many years were you in Pratt School?
I think about three.
3 years.
Well, it might not have been, I think around 3 to 4 anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Until we moved to, till we moved to Greenwood.
To Greenwood.
Yeah.
Do you remember Dad and Mom leaving the Amish?
I remember the preachers coming.
You remember the preachers coming?
Mm-hmm. We never saw them.
Uh-huh.
We were sent upstairs.
Oh, okay. You were sent upstairs, so you didn't see the preachers.
No, we didn't see them, but they came. Uh-huh. We children were sent upstairs, and we gathered around the stovepipe. And listen, but we didn't really understand,
mm-hmm.
and maybe we didn't, I don't remember what we heard, except we could hear our dad say that they, well, he said it in Dutch, that they didn't have any grounds, and I understood that to mean they had no land, and I remember thinking, oh, those poor people that don't have land.
Is that right?
Yeah, but I didn't know what grounds meant.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, that was... I didn't really remember it as a tragic time, and I just didn't know what was going on.
Didn't know what was going on, right.
No, it was not discussed that much.
Do you remember any of our hard men at that time, like Oliver Patton or Ben Downing or any of them?
Yes, I remember Oliver Patton and Ben Downing and...
Did they eat with us?
Yeah, they ate with us. I don't know if Oliver ate with us all the time or not. We were forbidden to go in his room.
Oh, is that right?
It was upstairs. He had a whole room. But we did go in now and then. We'd open the door a little bit. And we thought it had a funny smell. I liked to go in there and see if that funny smell was still in there. But I remember looking, I think we looked at his chest and it had a lining.
Uh-huh.
It had a lining like velvet, or not velvet, a felt.
Uh-huh.
I guess there's a motorcycle on our street, or a four-wheeler.
Yeah, right.
And the lining was felt, and he had knives and such things in there. I'm thinking he had a gun, too, but now that I say it, maybe it wasn't a gun. I remember the knives.
Uh-huh.
And but we just thought that was his stuff and thought nothing of it. We were not afraid of him.
Uh-huh.
He was a nice man. He helped Dad a lot. He was a prisoner.
Who was this, Ben Downing? Or?
No, they were all prisoners.
They're all prisoners,
I believe. Uh-huh.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Ben Downing and Oliver Patton were. And there was another man.
Oliver Patton was black.
Black, yeah.
Now, did
black.
Did he eat with us like that, or?
I believe Dad convinced him that he should eat with us.
Okay, but it wasn't the custom then.
No, it certainly was not a custom. But the fact that he lived with us was very odd.
Yeah, right.
We were not the normal.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
He could live in the same house. Now, if we'd have provided a little tenant house, that would have been acceptable.
Oh, okay. But live in the same house.
Live in the same house, and especially prisoners.
Prisoners, right.
With little children around.
Now, Ben Downing was superstitious. Do you remember anything about that?
Yes, I remember. He'd look out the windows a lot. And I remember that the neighbors and Dad would play tricks on him and try to scare him and aggravate his suspicions. And one time he had Mom upset because he said, there's a ghost out there. He saw it walking by. And Mom was dressed in her garb of white. She had white aprons or something on white.
Right.
And then she walked by the window and he said, there it is again.
It was Mom.
And it was Mom.
Mom was the ghost.
Right. And I guess he just accepted that then.
Yeah.
But
I don't
remember him fussing about it. But Ben Downing, he was more interesting. He would go down to the Bryant store and get Mary Jane candy.
Is that right?
Yeah, and then he would say, come sit on my lap and then you can have a piece of candy. And now that wouldn't go.
No,
was quite innocent. Innocent, nothing happened.
Right. He wasn't abusing you or anything like that.
No, and I didn't really want to sit on his lap, but I did because I wanted that candy. So I took the candy and got all. I never did like that sitting on people's laps. Uncle Elam was very much, come sit on my lap.
Oh, is that right? Uncle Elam was. He was
It was Aunt Florence's husband.
Yeah, right.
And one time he asked me, sit on my lap, and finally I went. And then he was just teasing me, and I had a hole in my shoe, in the toe part of my shoe.
Mm-hmm.
And he started tugging on my stocking. And he pulled my whole stocking off.
Off through the hole?
Through the hole in my shoe. And he remembered that not that many years before he died.
Is that right?
I asked him, do you remember doing that? And he said, yeah, he did.
Isn't that funny?
I don't know how he managed to get that whole stocking off.
Well, he came to your wedding.
Yeah, he did.
Yeah, so yeah. I remember that.
I remember. That was great. Yeah. He and the family.
Yeah. Now, what about your move to Greenwood? How did that affect you? Did you like it or excited?
Yeah, very excited because we had learned to know a few people by going to Greenwood Church.
Mm-hmm.
And it was moving. And you know, I loved to move. And it was so exciting to see the new house. And it didn't matter if it was ugly or nice or suitable or whatever. It was the fact that we moved.
Now, you were right in the middle of the woods.
Oh yeah, that's the part that was scary. You couldn't see another house or lights from anybody.
Anybody, right.
No. We were all by ourselves in a clearing in the middle of a woods. And we got used to it, but I never got used to walking through the woods.
Mm-hmm.
I was always a little bit afraid. I'd keep looking at both sides and at the stumps. And
You're right.
Stumps would look like animals. And,
and
the sounds were scary.
Mm-hmm.
And we just hurried through the woods. And I think there was a little stream through the woods, through the lane, and we had to cross that stream.
Mm-hmm.
And that was a little frightening. I don't know why things frightened me, but things frighten children. And one time I had to, it was my turn to help clean at the Greenwood Mennonite School, the little brown school.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't clean alone, but I was the only one in our family that had to clean.
Mm-hmm.
Until we got our cleaning done, it was getting dark. Until I got to the lane, it was dark.
Mm-hmm.
And when I went through the woods, I was just petrified going through the woods.
Mm-hmm.
But I wondered why I didn't, I don't remember that Mom was concerned that I wasn't home yet.
Mm-hmm.
But I had to walk by myself through the woods in the dark.
And that was about a mile and a half walk, wasn't it, to the school? And
probably,
or 2 miles?
Probably. It was over a mile.
Over a mile, right.
Well, I think our lane totally was a quarter of a mile,
right.
At least.
Yeah.
So it was a little hike.
A little hike, yeah.
And then another time I walked home when I had toothache by myself.
Mm-hmm.
And it wasn't that, it wasn't scary for weather or for darkness. It wasn't dark, but I was scared because I had toothache and I had to go by myself. And it just kind of bothered me.
Now, were you there when Lily cut her foot?
Yes, I was there when Lily cut her foot.
Lily gave her version. What's your version?
Yeah, my version is a little different than hers, but I think we were playing with water.
Oh, okay.
It was in the summertime, and I remember Lily threw, I don't know who threw water first. It wasn't meant to cause any harm. We were just having fun.
Fun, yeah.
And I remember getting the glass of water, and I said, Lily, I'm going to throw it on you. And so she said, oh, and she started running. And so I ran after her, and eventually she went out, got to the little barn that we had, and there was a place where you could get up on the roof.
Uh-huh.
And I don't know if she thought it was another building or what, but I kind of remember you come up out of the barn, you could get to the low side of the roof, and she got on the roof and jumped off, which it wasn't that far off the ground, but it was a healthy distance. I didn't go up on the roof.
Yeah.
But I went in the barn after her, still with my glass of water.
Yeah.
And when she jumped off the roof, she she just cried because she said, oh, you know, something hurt her foot.
Mm-hmm.
And here it was really bleeding.
Mm.
And we went out and got the little wagon and put her on the
wagon
and pulled her up to the house.
Wow. Was she still bleeding that time?
Yes, she was bleeding. Uh-huh. It was cut to the edge of her foot in quite deeply.
Uh-huh.
And so right away there was a big problem. Lily's bleeding and nobody's here to take her anywhere. What are we going to do?
There was no one in the house at all? No.
Well, Mom, but she didn't have a vehicle.
Right, right.
And so she said, go get Dad. We have to go get Dad.
So you went all the way to the sawmill with Lily?
No, we didn't take Lily.
Oh, didn't take Lily.
No, okay. And we had a bicycle. I think the bicycle actually belonged to Danny. I'm not sure.
Yeah, that's right.
But Danny wasn't home. He was at the sawmill,
yeah,
I think.
Yeah, right.
So John and I went to get Dad at the sawmill, to Eli Miller's.
Uh-huh.
And why we took the bike was not much help.
Yeah.
Because only one person could ride the bike.
Yeah, right.
So we took turns riding the bike. One would ride a while and the other would walk.
Would walk.
Yeah. And eventually it was so hot that eventually we got to Eli Miller's and Annie gave us water to drink. And then we went back to the sawmill and got Dad's attention. We said, Dad, Lily's hurt. Mom said, come to get you. And Dad looked at us and he said, I'll be home tonight. And then that was all he said.
And for all that, I'll be home tonight. You went
I'll
all
be home
this.
Tonight. So then we turned around and went back home. And I don't know if we even got another drink. We were so hot and thirsty. And when we got to the gravel pit, there was water in the gravel pit, but we were almost home by then.
Uh-huh.
The gravel pit was now doesn't have water in it.
Yeah, right.
But it did then.
It did then, yeah.
And so we stopped, and I remember we went down to the water edge, and we looked at each other, and we said, maybe it wouldn't hurt if we just had a little water from the gravel pit. But we ended up not drinking it.
Yeah.
We didn't drink it.
Didn't drink it.
But I know we went down there thinking we just have to have a drink.
Drink, yeah.
And we managed to get on home. So that was, then what happened when Dad came home, he did indeed do something. He took her to Lucy's.
Yeah, Lucy.
And by that time, it wasn't bleeding anymore.
Yeah.
And Lucy said, it really did need stitches, but at this stage of the game, she said, why don't we just wrap it up?
Mm-hmm.
And I think it healed up.
Healed up okay without anything else.
Yeah.
Now tell us what you remember of the Mennonite school, the one-room schoolhouse there. Who was your teacher there?
When I went to school, I think I was in fifth grade. No, wait a minute, maybe fourth grade.
Fourth grade.
Fourth grade. Uh-huh. And it was Gladys King.
Oh, she was my teacher too, so yeah. She must have had all the grades.
Yeah, and I liked her very much for a teacher.
Yeah, I did too.
And I remember the interesting part was listening to the classes recite.
Mm-hmm.
You could learn so much from hearing the grade above you recite.
Right.
And I enjoyed that and enjoyed the singing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I did too. And then as I got older in a couple years, we helped make out programs and participate in them and always religious programs.
Yeah, which you didn't have in the public school.
Yeah, we didn't have that in the public school. And we didn't have to worry about, can I do this or can I do that? We could participate in everything.
Yeah, right.
In the Mennonite school,
right.
Whereas we couldn't in the public school.
In the public school, right, right.
We would have liked to.
Right.
They would show movies.
Movies, things like that, which you couldn't
and
have.
And we weren't allowed to go.
Yeah.
And I wondered what Tom Sawyer would be like.
Yeah,
in
right, movie, right,
like
right.
Huckleberry Finn
yeah,
and
right.
Some of those things. But that was okay.
Didn't miss anything.
No.
Yeah, in fact, got to see the reruns later. So.
Yeah, we did. One thing I did, I don't know if any of the other children did, but in our room, one day the teacher put on some nice music, and it had a real catchy tune, and mm-hmm. had a little song to go with it, and then she said, okay, everybody divide out, and she put us in four corners, and she had the record player going, and then she told us what to do, and we all did it. I thought, I looked at it as a game.
Yeah, right, right.
It was a lot of fun.
Right, yeah.
And so when we got home from school that night, I said, oh, Mom, we did this and this in school, and I sang the song to her, and I said then what we did afterwards, and she looked at me and she said, you were square dancing.
Dancing square dance, right.
And I said, we were?
And, you didn't know it.
No, I didn't know it. She said, you shouldn't do that. I said, oh, well, I didn't know. I said, that was fun. But I don't remember ever doing it after that. It was a lot of fun.
Yeah, while you were doing it innocently.
Yeah. So, yeah, live and learn.
Yeah.
But it actually, there was no harm in it, I don't think. It was just a fun game for children. It certainly was harmless that day. I thought it was.
Now, tell about the move back to Dover. What was your impression there, moving back to Hartford?
Well, actually, I didn't really like that idea too much of going back.
Do you remember the move?
Yes, I remember the move. I think it was right around New Year's Day.
Right, it was Christmas.
New Year's Day. Very cold. We had some snow on the ground. And it was hard moving. And Mom was pregnant.
Is that right?
Yeah, she was pregnant with Bobby. Bobby was born that July.
Right, yeah.
So she was pregnant and probably just at the time when she felt sick.
Right.
But she didn't say anything about it. But I think the summer before we moved was the summer that Mom and Dad took a trip.
Right, now, to Indiana.
Indiana, maybe Ohio.
Clarence and I went along.
Yeah. And that summer, we had company. Lawrence instigated it. While you folks were in Ohio, then he said, let's have company for Sunday dinner.
Is that right?
Yeah, and we did. Lily and I were the cooks.
Is that right?
Yeah, and he brought in mostly some boys his age to eat dinner at home with us. And I remember making cake.
Uh-huh.
I don't know what else we had. I just remember the cake because the boys made a fuss about it.
Uh-huh.
And we had several layers, and I took food coloring and colored the layers different colors.
Is that right?
Because I thought that would be a party effect.
Party effect,
yeah,
right.
And probably colored the icing, too. I have to ask Lily if she remembers. And so we made this Sunday dinner for Lawrence and his friends, and we enjoyed it immensely. We thought it was fun doing the work. And I also remember that Lily and I canned the tomato juice and that were ready, and we did all the canning in that area.
Really? You canned yourself?
Yeah, while Mom was...
While Mom was gone, you did the canning.
Now, that would have been in 1947.
1940, we moved in 47, December, right?
Yeah, so that would have been the 47. I would have been 12.
12, right.
Yeah, so that would
have been
bad.
14.
She'd have been 14.
Yeah, yeah. So and then you, we moved back to Dover, and you went to Hartley School.
Yeah, we went back to Hartley School, and really, I think the same teachers were there.
Is that right?
Yeah,
who
was Mabel Massey.
Mabel Massey, yeah.
And then I had Mrs. Butts.
Okay.
I can't think of her first name.
Virginia.
Virginia Butts, yeah. And then Ralph Holland.
Ralph Holland. What was your impression of those teachers?
I really liked Mabel Massey.
Uh-huh.
Virginia Butts, she was a little more stern-looking.
Stern-looking, right.
Mabel Massey always smiled.
Yeah,
and
right.
She was pleasant. Yeah. And Mrs. Butts wasn't bad. It's just and lessons were a little harder.
Yeah,
so
right.
She was a little more stern, and she had a wart right here.
Yeah, right, that's right.
And I keep looking at that. And... So then Mr. Holland's room, I was pretty well scared of going there, yeah. But he turned out to be pretty decent.
Now, was he hard on the boys?
Oh, terrible. But they asked for it.
They asked for it, uh-huh.
Yeah, they wouldn't do their work, and they'd throw spitballs. And
did he shake anybody while you were there?
Absolutely. Up at the blackboard. They would put things on the blackboard other than their lessons, and he'd go up there and just get them by the neck and bang their heads on the blackboard.
Really? Get them by the neck and bang their heads on the blackboard.
And then if they were real bad, he'd put them in the cloakroom.
Really?
And where the coats were.
Like a little jail there, a detention area?
It was a little detention area. And I don't remember that he shut the door or how he did that.
Uh-huh.
I just remember him setting them in there.
Uh-huh.
And I think he had a desk in there. They had to sit there.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember a boy getting away one time, and he started out for the woods.
Yes.
And he left the class.
I remember that too.
And ran after him.
Yes, yeah. He came back with his hand on his neck.
Yes, he
saying,
did.
Saying, I got him.
Uh-huh.
It was a Nichols boy.
Yeah. I felt so bad for that boy.
Yeah, yeah.
And the poor Nichols boy, I know they were a poor family.
Yeah.
He'd come with his dad's shoes on. They were men's shoes. They were way bigger than he should have worn.
Yeah.
And but it was probably the only pair of shoes.
Shoes he had, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I remember that. And I also made friends with a girl and went home with her overnight.
Mm-hmm.
And the next morning, while I was at her house, trying to think what her name was. Don't think it was it wasn't a Terelius girl. It was another girl. Anyway, I spent the night there, and their food was different, but I ate their food. But the problem came the next morning, and I had long hair, and Mom always braided it.
Mm-hmm.
So they were anxious to take my braids out.
Mm-hmm.
Because nobody had long hair in the house but
mm-hmm.
me. And
mm-hmm.
they said, oh, this is so pretty. And so I sat in the chair, and they said, we'll comb your hair. They combed my hair out, and I said, we better hurry up, you know, and braid. You better braid my hair now. Oh, we can't braid. And so I said, oh, you know, I thought, what'll I do? And they said, well, no, just let it hang. It's beautiful. And oh, I didn't want to do that. I thought, what will Mom say? And I'm going to school. My hair's all down, but I had to go. Nobody could braid, and I couldn't reach back there good enough myself.
Yeah, yeah.
So
yeah, right. Right.
It just. I went to school that way. Yeah. And I had no breaths or anything.
Yeah.
Things happen.
Yeah, things happen. Now, did you memorize all those poems that Mr. Holland gave you?
Absolutely.
Annabelle Lee.
Yes. I can. And about the snowstorm.
Snowstorm. Right,
yeah. Yeah.
Old December gray.
The sunset. Something about the sun that gray December day.
Right. Set behind hills of gray or something.
Yeah,
like that.
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I think he was a very good teacher, and he was abusive to the point of.
Well, today they would have put him in jail.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
But he made us learn.
Yeah, yeah.
And he taught us, in good English, he taught us how to do, I don't know what you call it now, parsing, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Finding parts of sentences. Yeah, I enjoyed school, and I guess I hold a record of the first person to graduate from high school in our family.
In your family, right.
And Dad allowed me to go, maybe just because I just went.
Yeah.
And it was hard because I had to walk so far to catch the bus to Dover.
Yeah. Did you have some opposition from cows?
I had a lot of threatening cows chasing me. They never saw anybody walk on that road.
Did they actually get underneath the fence to try to get to you?
Well, no, not underneath the fence, but there was a part of the field that the farmer had not made a decent fence. There
uh-huh.
were parts of several fences. Some
uh-huh.
of the parts were laying down of the fence, and others were just kind of like a mat of fences.
Yeah, right.
And I remember the young cattle running up to the fence, and then they tried to go further, and they actually got their hoofs kind of stuck.
Stuck there.
Stuck in the fence. And when I saw that, I thought, I'm a goner. So I ran, the road was dug quite deeply down, and the banks went up on
both
sides.
Side,
so
right.
I ran up on the bank of the other side, and where the weeds were real tall, and I laid right flat down.
You had.
In that tall grass, and I kind of peeked through to watch what those cattle were doing. And there were horses in the field as well, and the horses kind of came over to see what the commotion was.
They all came over.
They all came over. So I just sat right there, real still, and finally they lost interest.
No,
and they gradually turned and headed toward the other
yeah,
way.
Right.
And when I watched my chance, and none of them were looking this way, I creeped on all fours for a little bit, real close to the ground, until I got to a little bit below the hill.
Uh-huh.
And so I got up, left my books, everything. I left it right in the grass.
Is that right?
And I ran home, and when I got to the lane, sure enough, there was our bull and another bull across the road.
Two bulls.
Oh, my, I just thought this day will never end. But I managed to get home and up to the house, and Danny, it was raining, too.
Mm-hmm. Wow, raining.
I was wearing a suit. I had, I don't know, was it a Goodwill or Salvation Army or a place like that?
Mm-hmm.
I had gone and looking for some school clothes that I thought would be suitable for Dover High School,
uh-huh.
and I bought a gabardine suit, and this suit was getting wet.
Uh-huh.
And it turned out okay. I think
mm-hmm.
I washed it and it turned out pretty good.
So you then did you graduate from Dover all at one time or all at one, you had a split there, didn't you?
Yeah, I only had ninth grade part of the year. I didn't finish ninth grade at Dover High. I started, but after that episode with the cows, I said, this is not worth it.
Oh, that was the thing that made you quit.
Right. So I took all my books, went back to school the next morning. And as I went to my classes, I handed in my books.
Oh, okay.
And when I got to my English teacher, Mrs. Anger.
Anger,
do you remember
right.
Mrs. Anger?
I remember Mrs. Anger, she was mine. Yeah,
I told her my situation. I said, I have a problem in getting to school. I have to walk so far. And I said, I have a lot of trouble getting there. I don't think I explained to her about the cows.
Yeah, uh-huh.
But I said, it'd be better if I didn't keep on at this time. And she just, she said, that is, I just can't hardly stand this. And she offered, would I please keep my English book?
Mm. Oh.
So I have it.
You have your still have that
I
English
think I
book?
Do, yeah.
Is
it's
that right?
Someplace. So I took my English book home. So that was pretty nice.
Yeah, it's pretty nice. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
So then, how did you finish high school then?
Well, Mom said you stay home this year, and she said maybe you can go down to Greenwood sometime mm-hmm. for high school, and I said I'd like that. So what I did that year, they took me to Stuart Stratt, Virginia to
mm-hmm.
help Grandma
mm-hmm.
with Grandpa. Grandpa was getting more and more disabled and
mm-hmm.
He was hard to manage.
Right.
And so I'm not sure if Grandma felt like she had more work since I was there or if I was any help, but I entertained Grandpa. And he enjoyed having somebody to tease and to go get his stuff. And I would walk down to the corner store for him to get ice cream. He
mm-hmm.
always liked black raspberry or black cherry, and I learned to like it too. And I enjoyed being at Grandma's house all summer.
So you were there
yeah.
for all summer long?
Yeah, he still would ride, drive the horse.
Oh, is that
because
right?
One day somebody told Grandpa if he drank pokeberry juice, it would help his arthritis.
Mm-hmm.
So he asked me to go, and I was the one to pick the pokeberries.
Oh, okay.
He sat in the buggy and drove the horse. And then when we would meet an oncoming car, he would put his arm around me and snuggle up. He said, they'll think I'm his girlfriend.
Oh.
I didn't like that. I thought that was demeaning. Here he is, long white beard.
Yeah, right.
I'm obviously young.
Yeah, you're obviously young.
He's teasing me. He was just teasing you,
right.
So I picked so many pokeberries. They're easy to pick. They grow in big clusters. And we took these pokeberries home, and then Grandma and I cooked them and made juice.
Uh-huh.
And we were always told they were poison.
Mm-hmm.
And he drank it.
Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
He drank it.
Similar to you would drink mm-hmm. orange juice. He didn't
mm-hmm.
drink a lot at a time, but he did drink it.
Now, he had talking parakeets, didn't he?
There were little birds. Yeah,
little birds, parakeets. But they would talk.
I think he had one named Jimmy. Didn't
Jimmy,
yeah.
Right. He would talk Dutch.
Yeah, Jimmy learned Dutch. And then he had the dog Tubby.
Tubby, uh-huh.
He'd stick Jimmy onto Tubby. And he said, I have a zoo with Jimmy and Tubby and Mommy.
Is that what he said?
Yeah. he said to Mom, I didn't hear him say this, but he said to Mom that he thinks if they could have kept me a few more months, I would have turned Amish.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't think so.
No.
But I enjoyed their young people. Yeah. They were people just like
yeah,
us.
Right,
I mean,
right.
they were fun to be with. And
yeah.
I was a little too young to go, but they let me go.
Let you go anyhow.
Yeah, because uh-huh. I was not, didn't belong to their group, so the
right.
restrictions for their group didn't apply
didn't
to me.
Apply to you. That's
yeah.
right. That's right. So you could go.
I didn't always go, just sometimes.
So, now, during this time, was this the time that you worked at Libby McNeil's?
No, I never worked at
You never worked at Libby McNeil Libby's?
Lily did.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Well, how did you get in contact with Slim and Purdy Boy then, since they were with little...
They just came to the house to see Lily. I didn't
know. Oh, okay. They were entirely with Lily. They weren't with you at all.
No.
Okay.
No.
But you did go to Kent General.
I went to Kent General soon after I got my license. I said, in the summertime, I said, say, this is nice. I can drive now. I can get a job.
Yeah.
I did have some jobs doing housework.
You worked for someone who was an x-ray technician, too, didn't you? X-ray in Wyoming. This man.
He was a photographer. Maybe he was x-ray. I'm not sure what he did.
Okay. But
was a photographer.
But you worked for him for a while.
Yeah, Lily did too. She
oh,
worked
she did?
For him first. And then either she didn't want to or I had to, she couldn't go or something. Then I took her place. Then I worked for a while.
You worked for a while.
I think I made $10 a week.
Yeah.
But if I worked Saturday, it'd be 12.
Wow.
And so I'd bring that money home. I don't remember really keeping my money.
And you just put it in the pot.
Yeah, it just was for the family. And yeah, I did work there.
I don't remember what his name was. Do you remember?
No, Forsman.
Forsman.
Forsman, yeah.
Okay.
I can't remember the first name. Maybe David? Dave?
Dave Forsman. Mm-hmm.
And the girls, the baby that I babysat for, that's why I was there. Let me see. She was the age of Bobby.
Oh, okay.
Isn't that, I think that's right. Well, no, she would have been younger because I remember telling the family that I have a baby brother and I took care of him, so I think I can take care of the
Forsman child, yeah.
And the only thing that happened that I didn't know what to do about was we had regular diapers. We didn't have disposable diapers.
Mm-hmm.
And when I was washing out a diaper in the toilet, that's how we were told to do it, it got away from me.
Oh.
And I didn't know if the toilet would ever work again after that diaper went through, but
uh-huh.
apparently it did.
Uh-huh. Now, how did you like your duties at Kent General as a nurse's aide? Were you a nurse's aide then?
I was a nurse's aide. We had training.
Were you in obstetrics?
We did. I think maybe... I was obstetrics part of the time, but then I worked up on the floor where they had wards.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
Okay.
And Lily stayed with obstetrics.
Okay,
and,
Lily stayed with obstetrics.
Yeah, and nursery.
And nursery.
And but part of the time, this is the amazing part, we had the segregation.
Mm-hmm.
So there was what they call the colored
ward, yeah.
And I had to supervise the 311 shift. I was charged.
You in charge?
Charge. At the colored ward.
The colored ward.
311.
311.
Charge nurse. And I was an aide.
An aide. You were the charge nurse there.
But if I had a problem, then I went over to where Evelyn Stokes. That was OBGYN.
Uh-huh.
And she was supposed to come over and
uh-huh.
check what I was, you know, having trouble with.
Uh-huh.
But when the doctors came over, I made the rounds.
Oh,
and,
wow.
I think, you know, why did I even do it? But I only did what I was told
yeah,
to do.
Yeah, what you're told to do.
Yeah. And yeah, did the charting.
Did the chart everything.
I made rounds with the doctors and worked on the charts and entertained.
And actually, no training.
Well, we had training.
You had training.
But certainly not an extensive training.
Extensive, right.
We did have a general training and you got a certificate. And... We carried medicine. Now we didn't, I don't believe I poured medicine.
Uh-huh.
I think the nurse did that, but we took it in.
You took it in.
And we also had to go in and inspect like wounds and do vital signs. Of course, that would be acceptable.
Yeah.
To inspect wounds and determine whether or not it was needed extra attention or...
Yeah. Now, were there any doctors you remember then, Dr. Layton or
oh,
Dr.
Yeah.
Wilson?
Dr. Wilson, Dr. Layton.
Really?
Both of them.
All of those, you remember, they knew
oh, yeah.
you and you knew them?
Absolutely. Yeah. In fact, I mean, there were three of us working at the hospital from our family. Danny, by that time, had worked as a maintenance.
Yeah.
And Lily, she was there. Lily was such a dependable person. She did everything in sight. She worked until the last thing was done, whether her shift was over or not.
Oh, really?
Yeah. We finished, and usually we let the next shift take over. Whatever needed to be done, they took over.
They took over, right.
Lily was very conscientious, and she would just stay there and work. She used to say, "Come on, Lily." "Well, I want to wash the bottles yet." Always a lot of baby bottles to wash.
Yeah, right.
And I think we did have a dishwasher to sterilize.
Okay. Nothing disposable.
Right? No disposable. Not even syringes.
Syringes or needles.
We had to, yeah.
They were all reusable.
The syringes and reuse them and sharpen needles.
Sharpen needles.
And shake down thermometers.
Shake down thermometers, yeah. Right.
Glass thermometers. Very interesting. And we also had a segregated nursery. A section of the nursery was walled off.
It was walled with colored.
Yeah, with the black baby.
Isn't that something?
They were just so cute. They are just immensely cute.
Yeah.
And always a thick head of hair.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's just unbelievable that that was allowed to happen.
Yeah.
But we were accustomed to it, and we liked them just as well as we did the others.
Yeah.
Now,
Dad became very upset with David Schwarzentuber. Do you remember any of that?
Oh, well, yes, I do remember that.
Did you date David after that or not? Or did
no,
he kind of,
I, yeah, David was and it. I dated probably 6 months or so.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah, and he had a Nash car. Well, that was, I think it was a family car, right?
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
And he'd come up to see if I could go here or there. And well, it was very handy. I wasn't really in love with David.
You're right.
But it was interesting.
It was interesting time.
Yeah, I had a boyfriend and go places and do some things, and so we had a time when we went to Harrisonburg for David the Shepherd Boy. I think it was some kind of a production, a special Easter production, and so I went with David, and Owen and Twyla went.
Uh-huh.
And then what I didn't know was Mark and Ella went.
Oh, okay.
And Ella was about at least 7 months pregnant.
Mm-hmm.
And they were our chaperones.
Oh, okay. So you had chaperones.
Yeah.
You had chaperones then.
We had chaperones. One of them sat in the front seat, one of the chaperones sat in the back seat. So it was a well-protected trip.
Yeah.
And that, it turned out okay. I'm sure it would have been okay anyway.
Yeah, right.
But anyway, then we made another trip that I think we took two trips, David and I, and that was one. Another trip we made to Longwood Gardens.
Uh-huh.
I believe that's where we had been. It got a little bit late.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not sure if that was the time Dad parked the truck on the bridge or whether it was another outing, but it may have been the Longwood Gardens.
Because that
was a little bit further. And anyway, wherever we were, David brought me up to the house. He didn't come in because it was time to
go.
I said, well, you know, see you later.
Was he late on purpose or
no,
it wasn't anything he did then.
It's a long ride
right
from Greenwood to Dover
right.
Until a function is over with, it's
right.
Going to be 9:30
right,
and then maybe it was 10:30 or 11. I don't remember the time. But anyway, walked in the house, everything's calm, cool, and I just went up to bed and never even looked out the window.
Mm-hmm.
Paid no attention. Went to bed, went to sleep, and next morning Mom said, well, did you know what happened last night? And I said, no, what happened? And she said, you didn't know Dad went out on the bridge? I said, no, what do you mean? She said, well, when you came in, Dad parked his truck. He was hiding, or he was waiting at the sawmill, and he parked his truck on the bridge of our lane, and nobody could get by. And so after he went in the house, David tried to go home, and here's the truck sitting on the bridge. So he sat there a little bit, and Dad came out of the sawmill. And then there was a conversation. And Dad was not very nice.
No, it said Dad said that David's knees were knocking.
Well, I imagine he didn't know what Dad was going to do. And Dad said, don't come back. And in essence, that's what he said. And so I said, oh, well, okay. That was it. I don't remember.
That was the end of that.
Yeah, I don't remember that I was really hurt or upset.
Yeah, right, right.
I wasn't, it wasn't like it was my future husband.
Right.
It was like some fun.
You had a protective father. That
yeah.
You
you know, nowadays children would probably really make a fuss.
Right, make a fuss, right.
Yeah, whatever.
Right, whatever.
Whatever they said, they you said, pretty much did.
Yeah, right.
So, but it was a little embarrassing. I'm sure it was embarrassing for David and kind of for me too, for a while.
Yeah, for a while, right.
Yeah. Now I've thanked Dad many a time since.
He knew about what
you
did.
Yeah, he had good judgment.
Judgment, right. Well, how did you meet Herman?
While I was at Greenwood going to school, I guess I'll back up a little bit, because I spent that summer taking my time to be with Grandma and Grandpa and helping out there. They said I could live down at Greenwood during the school week, mm-hmm. spend the week down there, go to school, and then hopefully could come home weekends, and which I did for a while, but a lot of weekends I didn't get to come home. It was kind of tough, but I stayed at Milt Schwartz and Troopers because Lawrence had connections with them, dating Carolyn, or maybe they were married. They might have soon gotten married after that.
Mm-hmm.
And so I stayed at Milt, and I became their housemaid.
Oh, okay.
And I did pretty much the cleaning and a lot of the cooking in the evening to pay off my board.
Mm-hmm.
And the boys were Johnny and Milton, and they rather enjoyed my cooking because, I made different foods.
Different foods than what
their mom was making.
Was making.
And they enjoyed having me at the house,
yeah,
too, you
right.
know. And a lot of people thought I dated Milton. I didn't.
Yeah,
I never
didn't.
Dated
never
Milton.
Never dated
no.
Milton.
Mm-hmm. For right. one thing, because I lived there, I
right.
didn't think that was proper.
Right.
And
right.
I actually did date, Willard Beachy.
Oh, Willard Beachy, okay. You dated him for
Willard Beachy for a while.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, but that was over with. But while I was at Milt's house, going mm-hmm. to school there, and probably was age 16 yet. I was young.
Mm-hmm.
Part of Herman's family came to visit.
Mm-hmm.
And it was Sam and Betty Schwarzentrooper who live here in Florida.
Yeah,
over
with
here.
You. Uh-huh.
And they brought Herman and Mamie and Shirley along.
Now, were Sam and Betty married at that time?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
They were married. And so they brought these three, Herman and his two sisters, along. And I happened to be at the house that weekend.
Oh,
I didn't go home that weekend, so I was at the house, at Milt's
house. Okay, okay.
And so here's these Michigan people coming around. And Elizabeth had met Willard previously,
mm-hmm.
but Willard wasn't along.
Okay.
As far as I know, Willard wasn't along. But she was talking about him, and she said they're really nice people, and mm-hmm. Herman was along. And he didn't have a girlfriend, had never dated anybody.
Mm-hmm.
He was a little older than I was. I think he was close to 20.
Mm-hmm.
And I kind of got acquainted. And I think maybe we went out on a boat ride
mm-hmm.
On Haven Lake in Milford, some of us.
Mm-hmm.
And so we started writing. That's when I first met him.
So you started to correspond with her.
Right. Mm-hmm. And then he was going to come out and visit me, and I said, I think maybe he shouldn't do that.
Uh-huh.
I didn't think that I was ready to be that serious.
Right.
And I said, don't come.
Uh-huh.
And he didn't like that too good.
Uh-huh.
But then for a while we didn't write.
Uh-huh.
But then when Willard and Elizabeth got married later on, we started up again.
Oh, okay.
And so that resulted in us getting married.
Okay, at that time.
Yeah.
So Sam was related to the Schwarzentroopers.
Sam is, a first cousin to the other Schwarzentroopers that we know, like Elizabeth and David and Eli Schwarzentroopers gang.
Gang, yeah.
Noah is a brother to Laban, to Eli, to Ernest.
Okay.
Do all the Schwarzenegger.
Okay, so that was a connection.
Yeah, that's a connection. And their home house in Greenwood, when the Noah Schwarzenegger family lived there, their home was where we know Alvin Mast to have lived, mm-hmm. close to our church.
Mm-hmm.
So,
And then you moved to Michigan.
We got married December the 4th. We've been married 53 years. This year will be 54.
54, yeah. Mm-hmm. You're 10 years
ahead. We moved to Lansing, Michigan, because Herman he had completed his obligation for service, but had arranged to stay there 3 or 4 months, yeah,
mm-hmm.
until spring. So we lived in the heart of Lansing, got an apartment, and
In the winter time. Cold.
Terribly cold. First morning we were in that apartment, when we got awake, I was going to push the curtain back to look out the window, and the curtain wouldn't move. There was so much ice on the window, it had frozen the curtain up against the window. Couldn't see out. And we had 7 windows in our bedroom, real close together. It's like a porch.
Like a porch, uh-huh.
And one little window about this square in the living room. But that was good because it kept the room warmer.
You were warm, yeah. right. And so you were about almost about ready to move back to Delaware.
It was hard. I didn't like living in the city at all.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And some mm-hmm. people like it. Yeah. I didn't like it. But it was still fun.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So Kenny and Randy were both born in Michigan?
They were, but not at that house.
Okay.
We had Ken later on in 1955, in November, and he was born in Midland, Michigan.
Oh, okay.
And so we didn't have a house of our own. We had lived with his parents for a while, and so we decided we have to get a house. So mm-hmm. we moved up beside a cemetery. In Midland there for a while until we found a place to work way up in the Fairview area, a mm-hmm. little town called Curran. And that was way north. It was very cold, ice and snow all winter long. You never saw grass. And Herman's job was to take care of cattle. Our driveway, our lane, I should call it a lane, was almost a mile long.
Wow.
Way back in. It was a ranch, a regular ranch.
Regular ranch, yeah.
We had a house, a very, very suitable house.
Mm-hmm.
And we just made do. We had very little to worry about, except is it going to snow or what's the weather going to be like?
Yeah, right.
And Kenny did fine. He got sick once, but not severely.
Yeah, severely, uh-huh.
Then so, Randy was born in 58, and by 1958, Herman was tired of the farm work because there wasn't enough money for both him and his dad.
Right.
So we decided to move to Delaware.
Oh, so you moved to Delaware in 1958.
Yeah, 1958, by May, I mm-hmm. think. By the end of May, we had moved to Delaware.
Yeah, uh-huh.
And Dad gave him work. And uh-huh. then, Herman paid, our dad got Herman to work for him.
Uh-huh.
And paid him
right.
For working, plus gave him a house to live in.
Yeah, mm-hmm. So, when you moved back to Delaware then, where was Fonda born?
Well, actually, we moved to Delaware and we lived in the Greenwood area. And when I got pregnant with Fonda, I felt like I wanted to go back to Michigan to have the baby because I had great confidence in my obstetrician there.
Mm-hmm.
And I did have some problems. I had problems with Ken.
Uh-huh.
And I passed out.
And
I fell out of bed and all this stuff. And my history. This uh-huh. doctor knew my history. I think it was because I had a saddle block.
Oh, okay.
And so I went. We went back, and Fonda was born. And
in Michigan.
In Michigan. And a few months after that, we moved back again.
So all 3 of your children were born in Michigan.
Right. Those three children
born in Michigan.
I don't know why we made that big move.
Huh.
But part of it was because Herman kind of felt like maybe he'd rather live in Michigan. He was uncertain
uh-huh.
about where we would be best off living.
Yeah.
But once he went back, he said it wasn't long until he knew.
Yeah.
I think we belong in Delaware. And and I was glad of that because I was hoping to come back.
Well, now how, what made you decide to adopt?
We we didn't really just decide that without a little stimulation, because there was the war was going on, and we
Which
would
war
hear.
Was that?
Yeah. Uh-huh. It was, but the children that they were seeking help for were from Cambodia. And they would put the pleas out in the papers, on the news, say, we need homes for the Cambodian children. And we were living on a farm in Greenwood. We had lots of room. And we were talking about this. There were also a lot of pleas out for money to help children. I said, well, I would love to help children if I have them in my home. But just to send money, I don't know really what I'm doing.
Well, yeah, where it's going.
And so we talked about this, and as a family, we said, well, it would be nice to help a child. Shall we do it? And, you know, shall we? And we thought, well, yeah, we should. We should. We prayed about it, and we decided we would help. So we made the call, and they took the information, and they said, you will get a child.
Is that right? Yeah. A Cambodian child?
You would get a child. There's no guarantee, boy, girl, age, it'll be a child.
Right.
But you have to be responsible for the health care. It'll probably be sick. Yeah. You have to go to New York, I think, or Philly to get it, wherever the plane comes in at. And you have to accept responsibility for the child's health immediately. And we said we'd do that. Got the crib, got ready, and the date was set.
Is that
yeah,
right?
The date was set. We got the call. They said, you're getting a child. The plane is such and such a time. And keep in touch. You couldn't leave the house. You had to stay with it. And the next call we got said something happened. The plane that was loaded was shot down. And the next plane was loaded but didn't go off. And it didn't take off. Our child was on the next plane.
So your child stayed behind.
Yeah, our child stayed behind, and it never took off.
Never took off.
But the other plane was shot down.
Was shot down.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Terrible. And nurses and all were on that plane.
Wow.
And so they just disbanded the program there. But they said.
But you had the crib.
We had the crib. And the child, they said, was adoptable. It had birth certificates with it. And we were really disappointed because we had gotten ready. We were so involved emotionally for this child.
Right.
But, you know, it was settled, and we let it go. And it was that summer that a couple, we had shared this. I was in a ladies' prayer group, and I had shared our experience and how disappointed we were.
Yeah.
And a lady that was in that prayer group happened to be on vacation, just happened to be, I'd say it was meant to be. She was in Missouri, and a missionary from Canada was there as well. And she said, we have this family in Canada that has three children that need homes. And my friend Margaret, who was in my prayer group, thought about me.
Is that right?
She said, well, I know a family who got ready for a baby, and then it didn't come.
Yeah.
You know, it was a foreign baby.
Right, a foreign baby, right.
And she said, shall I call them? And they said, yeah, call them. We need homes. So they called it. It was 4th of July.
Wow.
And I had Herman's family were visiting us. I had a whole house full of guests. And they were at the table eating, and the phone went. And I told Herman, would you answer the phone? And he said, I'll go upstairs and get the phone. We had an extension phone.
Yeah, right.
So he went upstairs, and pretty soon he hollered down. He said, pick up the phone. I said, oh, I don't have time. I said, I'm like Martha. I said, I have all this to do. I said, we're ready, you know, for this and that in the kitchen. I said, whatever you decide, I'll go with that. You just, whoever it is, you answer for me. I'll go with whatever you decide. Don't worry about it. He said, not this. He said, you get on the phone. So I thought, well, that sounds urgent. So I got on the phone, and here they're telling me that there is a baby in Canada who needs a home. Would you take it? It's a little girl. And Herman's upstairs, and I'm downstairs. We can't even look at each other. And he said, Herman, yeah, I guess. Shall we? And he said, yeah, let's. And so we decided this on the phone. And we we just thought, well, it would have been nice if we'd have been standing right together, but
right.
we couldn't hear we're having a baby. He's upstairs and I'm downstairs and we're having a baby. So I think I ran upstairs to him and I said, well, you know, we have to go right away. They said we have to go right away. This baby's been starved. So we went downstairs and we told our family, we're having a baby. We've got to leave. And so they said, what? And we had to explain it. It was just unheard of. And so we left. We didn't leave. We got help. We had never done this before. We had to buy a plane ticket, and we did it on the phone.
You did it on the phone? Yes. Bought a plane ticket.
And I think Herman went and picked them up then.
Is that
plane
right?
Ticket.
Uh-huh.
And
uh-huh.
By the next morning, we were on the plane.
Is that right?
That's right. We
to
told
where?
Our family, we're leaving. Have fun.
where are you headed for?
We had to fly into Thunder Bay, Ontario.
Thunder Bay, yeah. Ontario. Right.
And so we did. We talked to an Indian family. They were hard to understand, and we were probably equally hard to understand. But we flew up there, and the Indian gentleman, who ended up coming to Delaware as well, and he picked us up at the airport, took us to his house, and we picked up Mona and went to a mission's house from there, a missionary's place.
Uh-huh.
And we slept there that night and asked for the father. The mother did not come back, but the father had gotten out of jail.
Hmm.
And he held the baby. I took a picture.
You have the picture yet?
I have the picture. And he signed it. I wrote a contract. Just made up this contract absolving us of any obligation if
right.
something
happened
that we couldn't control.
Right.
And he signed it and dated it, and we did the same. And we came home with her, and 6 months later, we had the privilege of choosing if we wanted Michelle or not. And
Michelle was the sister, right?
Yeah, older sister.
Mm-hmm. Older sister. So you got Mona first, then Michelle.
Got Mona first, because Michelle was a little older, and other people had taken care of her, and they thought the mother would want her.
Yeah.
And they would let the mother have a chance.
Yeah.
And then she didn't come back.
Yeah.
So then we got to keep her, too. And they are fully adopted. And citizens, by the time they were, I think, 12, they were both adopted and became citizens.
Citizens by the time they were 12.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I couldn't imagine life without them. They're just as much a part of our family as any others.
Right.
It's great having
them.
It evened out our family, 3 boys, 3 girls.
Oh.
Yeah, just meant to be.
Yeah, 3 boys, 3 girls. So, how did Herman get into chickens?
We lived in Dover before, I think, before we had Fonda. Before we had Fonda, we lived at Joe Byler's farm, originally known as the Giloff farm.
Oh, okay, the Giloff.
Right, Giloff farm. And he had lots of chicken houses and I think some turkeys as well.
Mm-hmm.
And Mr. Giloff was our first, I think he was our first landlord, and then Joe Byler's moved in.
Uh-huh.
But after Joe's moved in, we soon left. Not because he would have been more desirable landowner, but we wanted to get started on our own.
On your own, okay.
So he took care of chickens for them.
Oh, okay.
And when we had opportunity to buy a chicken farm later, he had some experience in that.
Mm-hmm.
And he was willing to try it on his own.
Wow.
And so
that's
how we got in. And we started in 1975, I believe.
75. Uh-huh. Were you with Purdue then?
Yes. Our first flock of chickens was with Purdue, but he soon talked around to other people and found out that they were a little difficult to work with, and he chose to work with Swift.
Oh,
and so we went with Swift, and then they sold out. And then by the time that happened, he was thinking about selling the chicken farm.
Mm-hmm.
Not they didn't want chickens, but he had, the boys were starting to work for themselves, and he had more work than he could handle, mm-hmm. and didn't want to give up his lime truck. So he decided we'd sell the farm, and that way he could work on the lime truck, and I wanted to go back to school.
Okay, so you went back to nursing.
I went back to school, yeah, I went to college. Updated my nursing career to an RN.
What made you decide to do that?
Well, I had worked as an LP, not as an LPN. I worked as a practical nurse, but not a licensed one. Mm-hmm. And I worked at Country Rest Home 8 years.
Mm-hmm. You had a lot of experience.
So I gathered up a lot of experience. I liked it, and I just thought after my children, I'll go to school, then I'll take up school again.
And you went in with Fonda, right?
Fonda and I started college together. And then she dropped out of the nursing program for a year, and I finished up, and she went back later.
Why did she drop out?
She came out as an LPN.
Oh, okay.
She wanted to work and get some money.
Okay.
And try to get on her own. Mm-hmm. And so she actually went back to school later and got her RN later.
Mm-hmm.
And so we graduated as an RN different years.
Uh-huh.
That was okay.
But you started the same year.
But we started, college together.
Mother and daughter.
Yeah, they said, oh, this is not unusual. This is very, done before.
Oh, really?
I think I was in my 40s, maybe 40, I don't know, was that 46 or 7 when I'd start just slow.
Yeah. Well, didn't you earlier in life had to choose between Herman and a nursing scholarship?
Oh, yeah. That was when I graduated from high school. I had a scholarship.
You had a nurse. Where was that scholarship to?
To Wilmington Hospital for 3 years.
For 3 years.
Yeah. All tuition paid.
Uh-huh.
And
what did your mom and dad think of that?
Mom didn't, she didn't like the idea of me living in the city.
Uh-huh.
And I thought it was wonderful by then. Of course, I knew nothing about living in the city.
Uh-huh.
But Dad said he knew Herman and I were dating.
Uh-huh.
Herman had come out to our graduation, to my graduation.
Uh-huh.
And then he wanted, he was thinking marriage.
Uh-huh.
And Dad said, well, if you're just going to get married, there's no need for you to go to nurse's training.
So you had no opposition from your parents, really?
No.
They thought it was foolish to go to nursing school if you were going to get married.
If you're going to get married. And that would be the end of that.
Yeah.
But it never left my mind. And I always wanted to go back to be a nurse. I still have my scholarship.
You still have your scholarship? You could go?
I could possibly go if there was a school of nursing there, but I don't think there is.
No, there isn't. I think it's all changed.
Yeah,
now.
I kept
those
things.
Yeah. Wow. So now, what are your plans now from here on out?
Well, we have this little house in Florida, and we come here in the winter, and Herman is hesitant to leave his chicken farm of his... He just has a love for raising chickens. He's very good at it. He's one of the top growers. He loves to help other people, give them some advice if they ask
for
it. But really, he said, it's just, it's not hard to grow chickens. You got to stay out there and do your job. And
mm-hmm.
so...
And he started Sam on his thing. And then Herman started.
Yeah, Sam and Mona are raising twice as many chickens as we are, and they're doing well. And I think Mona gets tired of chickens too, just like I would.
Yeah.
But still, it's a good way to raise a family. They help their work for little ones, and they can help and be a part of it. And we just plan to do what we're doing right now until Herman sees that he can't do this
mm-hmm.
chicken house work
mm-hmm.
anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we can get a little doggy house.
Maybe a little doggy house.
I don't think that we will ever live in Florida full time.
Okay. Even though it's nice and warm
here. It's nice and warm and nice and hot in the summer. But the main reason we wouldn't is because none of our children live here. And mm-hmm. we have a tendency to...
want to go visit them.
We're very fond of our grandchildren.
Grandchildren, right.
They're a big part of our life.
All right, yeah.
So,
well, thank you very much, Irene. And we have appreciated you being a guide for the rest of the family on how to be stable.
Well, we have our Times do.
Yeah, all of us do.
Yeah, I appreciate my family.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Willie, for this opportunity.
You're welcome.